It's Wednesday, and we're going to do this like we've been doing it for 11 years. We usually meet in the lobby of the public theater, but since this COVID thing, we've been totally going online like this, and we wanted to give a shout out and a deep thank you to the public theater for supporting us for these past 11 years doing Watch Me Work, and also HowlRound has been awesome in pulling it all together. So this is what we do. For those of you who are new, or for those of you who have maybe forgotten since yesterday, we work for 20 minutes together, any kind of work you want. And then I take your questions about your work and your creative process. And should you have a question, Audrey is gonna tell you how to get in touch. Go, Audrey.
Thanks, SLP. So yes, if you have forgotten since yesterday, here's how to ask a question. If you're inside of the Zoom, all you need to do is click on the participant tab, likely at the bottom of your screen on a laptop or the top if you're on an iPad or a tablet. And once you click on the participant screen, there's a little raise your hand button. It'll pop up a little blue hand, and I'll call on you if there's time. If you're watching on HowlRound.tv, you can tweet at us at WatchMeWorkSLP with the hashtag HowlRound, H-O-W-L-R-O-U-N-D. Or you can tweet at the Public Theater's account, which is at Public Theater NY, or write to the Public Theater's Instagram. And that's it.
All right. Okay. Here we go. Here we go. Ready? Here we go. Yeah. Is that a new tone?
Well, I can't find my phone, so I have to use a different item.
Do you want me to call you?
Philip just called me. It's somewhere in this house. I don't ever leave, but thank you.
You never leave. Yeah. All right. Well, okay. Hey, so anybody have a question, or should we practice our posture?
Oh, we don't have a question quite yet.
Oh, good.
Oh, my back cracked. Oh, we have a question.
Your back cracked.
Yeah. Mary, you're up.
Mary.
Are you there?
Can you hear me now?
Yeah. Hi.
Hey. Okay. Hi. Hi, Susan, Lori. Hey. So, hi. So I came to this all a bit late. I've been here all week, and then I was here one session previous before that long week break. So I'm excited. I'm nervous to ask a question, but here goes.
Okay, I'm ready.
Okay. All right. So I've come to writing later in life. My mode of artistic expression has been acting and performing. So I come to theater and the arts through that. Can't really do that anymore. Can do improv. I've been taking a writing class for about 5 years that is all different kinds of writing. So it's great. I feel free to write what I want to write. And a play developed out of a short story that I wrote 2 years ago. That became a 15-minute play. Now it's about an hour, and I'm hoping it'll be a full length.
Cool.
Okay, so here's where I am. We were talking about flow a couple nights ago. My process has been my process. It's been sometimes I've been coasting along. Mm-hmm. Sometimes I've been the river's really slow. That's okay. I can reflect upon what's around me. Now I'm kind of stuck in an eddy. Mm-hmm. And I think that what I tell myself and what I'm starting to believe, and I think this is leading to me being quite stuck, is I don't know where this goes. I don't know where this goes. My process, a lot of it has been born of images coming to me. Mm-hmm. It's a lot of it is it's sort of metaphorical about aspects of my life. Mm-hmm. So, because my life is unfinished, I can't, it's not a direct story. I can't use that. And I find that I'm getting kind of stuck in my editor part, mm-hmm. the analytical. Well, what's the arc? Where is this going? How is this? And so and it's almost like I know how to unstuck myself, and I've got all these tools at hand, but either I'm not doing them, or they're not the right ones for me right now.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. So I could tell you more. You could just respond to.
No, it's exciting. It's exciting, Mary, because you know during this time where we're in some sort of isolation, you know, you've chosen to, you know, ramp up your writing, which is great. It's hard, in my experience anyway, it's really cool what you're doing because it's hard to try new things, you know, especially when we are, you know, somewhat accomplished or somewhat accustomed to doing other things, you know. Mm-hmm. So you do a lot of acting, you know, and now you've been trying this writing thing. And so you have to, I hope you feel really proud of yourself, first of all. Do you?
Yeah, I do. I do.
Good, good. That's very important. It's like it's a big deal. You know, it's like I do yoga every day. And every time I even make an attempt at one of those really hard poses that like makes me go, I say to myself, I'm proud of myself. So keep with everything else you're feeling, make sure you add, keep adding that ingredient in there because you're doing something big. Okay. You have a lot of tools and they don't seem to be working. So we could give you some, maybe you have these already, you know, and if you do, that's okay. Maybe you can just try them. I would, the main tool that is always best for me anyway, is showing up. Mm-hmm. So can you say with regularity, i.e. every day for a piece of time, it can be 20 minutes or it can be longer. Can you tell us that you're showing up every day for your work?
Okay. I have not been showing up every day. So okay. I can say to you all that I will show up every day.
You can try. It doesn't
I have can to, try for 20 minutes.
It doesn't have to be like 5 hours, you know, it doesn't have to be heroic. You know what I'm saying? Right? Mm-hmm. You know, it just show up every day. That is something that I all without fail, that one works because even if the writing is not good, which is mm-hmm. a judgment, mm-hmm. I can tell myself at the end of the day, I tried. Mm-hmm. And although I don't know who said it, Yoda, there is no try, there is only do and not do, whatever Yoda says, somebody like that said it. You know, to me, that is, I like to think of the Bhagavad Gita, no effort is ever wasted. Mm-hmm. And so what we're doing is we're putting in the time, we're displaying faith. We are preparing ourselves to receive the sacred. And there you go, you sit at your desk or wherever you write and you show up, okay? You can try that. Other things could be writing. I mean, I'm into outlining. I don't know.
Let me address that. So because the nexus of the story was just sort of born, you know, as a spontaneous thing, and it had that big creative juicy bubble thing. Right. I haven't been inclined to use an outline, but I did. This is what I did the past 20 minutes. I made it. I wrote on the cards.
Oh, okay.
The scenes so far. Okay. You know, and they can be rearranged. And then I just started improvising other scenes moving forward.
Yeah.
And I thought I can just drop them. I don't. Uh-huh. Not uh-huh. Right. Practice non-attachment.
There you go. Well, girlfriend, let me tell you, as a professional, that doesn't sound like you're stuck to me. That sounds like you're working. That sounds like fun. Like you wrote scenes out on cards. You just started brainstorming and spitballing and improvising other scenes. They can go wherever they go. And it sounds like you're moving.
Well, I just did it the past 20 minutes. So... Yeah.
There you go.
Okay, I'll keep on keeping that.
Do you have a time of day that is more possible than not for you to show up for your writing? Do you have a certain time of day, morning, afternoon, evening?
It's probably after I've had my coffee. And then also in the quiet of the night, say 10 p.m.
Okay. Yeah. So after you have your coffee, I'm assuming that's morning.
Yeah.
After I've had my first drink. No, 7 a.m. No. So after I've had my coffee. Okay. So why don't you see if it feels good, if you can do 20 minutes in the morning after you've had your coffee.
Okay.
It's great because then you get an extra bonus, Mary, of having done it already. And the rest of your day, you can frolic in the periwinkle. Really?
Right.
You know what I'm saying? You know? And then if you want to pick up an extra 20 minutes with us, you know, Monday through Thursday, and then you want to maybe you might pick up an extra 20 minutes in the quiet of the evening, maybe, you know?
Right.
You know?
Okay.
Okay.
All right.
Okay.
Thank you, Suzan. So,
you're welcome.
Thanks, Mary. Up next, we've got Jack. Jack. Hi.
Hello. Hi. Big fan. questions. So the question is kind of a continuation of some of the subjects from yesterday, but in terms of character development and new work. And it's on my mind a lot because I think it happens a lot in writing and also acting. So I'm writing this new character and I can see how this character could be perceived as a stereotype. And you know, the same thing happens sometimes with writing when we say, oh, that's a cliche, but is it a good cliche or a bad cliche and things like that. So like I've been doing the work of trying to go deeper into making sure, and I think now I've sort of realized, well, he's not a stereotype, but he's upset. He wants to be a stereotype. He's obsessed. And that's also kind of disturbing. But so just more insight, I suppose, in how to either prevent people from perceiving your characters or your work as a cliche or a stereotype, or just preventing that from happening. So like, even if they're like, okay, yeah, we've seen this kind of, that makes sense because those kinds of people are like that and they have those kinds of problems, but how to get past that and how to bring the audience past that, not just the backstory of the actor or the writer. Any insights?
I love your question, Jack, because it goes to the heart of something that's has interested me for a long time, controlling other people. So how do we make sure that the audience doesn't do something or other? Yes, of course. It's an exciting prospect. And let us put it on the pile of things that we cannot control. Because no matter how brilliant your writing is, we cannot control the responses of the people who see it, right? Because people are gonna bring their own shit to the party and you know, right? So let us let that go if we can. Let's try to let that go and maybe replace it with things that we can do something about, which are make our characters, regardless of their specifics, real and deep and meaningful, right? Because people are gonna think whatever the fuck they think, right? I mean, right? Okay, so, right, so hey, right? But we can make our characters rich and nuanced and meaningful, okay? So maybe if you find yourself going, gee, that's a stereotype or that's a cliche, ask the next question might be why? You know, why? Oh, because he always wears a red hat everywhere. Really? Why? You know what I mean? I mean, whatever, you know, right? I mean, so you can keep asking, you can continue to be curious. I think stereotypes or, you know, when we judge people from afar, look at that person over there, they're a such and such, you know what I mean? We stop being curious.
Right.
And we read them poorly and quickly and make a snap judgment based on, I don't know what, the shoes they're wearing and their height and whether or not they're pushing a stroller and, you know, whatever, right? And we make our judgment and then we're done. Instead of being curious and continuing to look, I'm practicing it right now because I have a window here. I'm looking out the window and imagining. I continue to look at that person, that character, and I continue to look at them and I continue to look at them and I don't stop looking at them until I'm finished writing the play or the novel or the poem or the song or the whatever, you know?
Okay.
Which is another way of saying respect, right? Okay, so keep looking at them, keep asking yourself, what is with, you know, what's up with my character, you know? What's their story, okay?
Well, often as an actor, I hear the voices of the characters in my head and then I'm just acting and writing. It's fun. I'm like, oh, I've done the whole show. But, you know, what I enjoyed from, you know, hearing you speak and getting these new insights is looking at some of these characters that, you know, I hear them and I feel like they're kind of being channeled, but then kind of really trying to go a little bit deeper. I'd like to go just a little bit deeper. And so I guess if the audience gets it, most of the time I think they do, but still it's like, you know, I understand letting that go, but yeah, like, I guess, yeah, letting, being free of that prison of worryings. I mean, that could go back to another question that I was going to have too, because that's happened to me. I'm sure it's happened to a lot of people where one person's like, that was great, fantastic. And the other person's like, oh my God, that's a mess. Like, but that's supposed to be a mess. No, it's a mess. Yeah. So it's like, I try to always filter criticism. I take the good and try to understand it. But right. I guess when you're doing, mostly I just enjoy creating. So I don't, even if I didn't want to do it, I just do it.
You think of like a play that, scholars throughout the ages have agreed on as a fine work of literature, like, Hamlet, for example. Okay, well, some people think Hamlet's fucking boring. And Hamlet, the character is dumb. Like, why don't he just do it already? Right? What is all this talking, right? I mean, so there's different takes on everything. That's somebody else's work, and not being able to control the reaction from the audience. And for your own work, yeah, people are gonna say what they're gonna say. If you have a writing group or a group of trusted friends, hopefully their critiques and their feedback is going to encourage you forward,
right,
instead of shut you down. If you are getting critiques and feedback from people, trusted friends, and it's shutting you down, then push pause on that feedback loop. That doesn't mean they're not your friends. Some people don't know how to give positive and helpful feedback. Helpful, not just positive, helpful. Okay, so just be mindful of that.
Yeah. Great, I liked conversation. I like hearing what you, I love hearing what everybody else asks too. I usually find if I just am quiet, somebody asks my question, but today I thought, well.
It's nice that you're asking your own question though. Yeah,
okay.
Thanks, Jack.
All right, up next we've got Lou. Are you there?
Yes. Hi.
Hey, Lou. How are you?
Hey, good to see you. I'm doing okay today, actually. I wasn't going to say this, but you asked me the question. I had to put my cat from 10 years to sleep last night. My cat. Yeah. It's not what I wanted to talk to you about, but I guess I have to bring it in because it's part of how I am. So.
Oh, I'm so sorry.
Thank you. Yeah, it actually has been interesting to have that experience in line with a whole other set of experiences over the last week, which is about my work that was stuck. I think we talked, you may remember, I had a book proposal sort of floundered a little bit, and I've been stuck, and I've been working with some really exciting collaborators, trusted people, and I'm starting to think of new ways in, and I've been really excited, and it's been going. And then that thing happened last night with my loss, and I'm very sad about it, but I also feel like it's something energetic. I don't want to say too, that's not what I actually wanted to talk to you about, but it's something energetic is like moving. And I loved him, I miss him, and it was hard, but it was like making space for something else. But what I did want to ask about is one thing I've come to realize about the project that I've been working on for a while, which is a memoir, which I always feel self-conscious about because it's right. Like, why me and blah, blah. Well, I'm starting to understand, some of the themes, the things I want to talk about, I think are relevant and have a reason to be, and I'm getting more confident. I come here all the time, and I'm like, I feel like I got my boxing gloves hanging by, I feel like I'm a little like in training to like trust myself. I'm going to try to bring my point. I'm writing about a lot of years and a lot of time, and I'm working now to bring it in and focus it. And I have some ideas about how to do that. But I think I just wanted to bring to you in this space, how do you know, like the image I have in my mind is like a tofu press, when you make tofu and you squeeze out all the water and you make it, it's real tight and it tastes better. Like, how do you know what to like squeeze out of a project? And like extract, and do you find that you have to sort of write it all before you can squeeze it out, or do you sort of can you find a way to figure out like what the important parts are of a project before you sort of sit down to do it, or do you have to write the War and Peace before you can write the haiku, so that I'm just like thinking about that. I just love your take on it, because I'm feeling like I know how to tighten things up, but I'm also feeling like I started from such a big swath of time and material. How do I sort of bring it in? And I'll stop.
Right. No, that's really good. I just want to ask you one question, which, what's your cat's name?
Aiden.
Yeah. What color was he?
He was orange and white.
Oh, pretty. Handsome.
Yeah, he was handsome, very handsome guy.
Well, that's great, man.
Yeah, thanks.
No, I mean, you know, I like to write and then rewrite, you know? I don't generally, you know, edit while I'm in the flow of writing, because I feel like they have two different energetic wavelengths, you know? Mm-hmm. It's like if you're surfing, have you ever been surfing? Well, anyway, even if you haven't, you're out there. I mean, I used to go surfing when I lived in Los Angeles. You're out there and you paddle out. That's one thing you got to do to surf. And then you hop on your board and you ride back in, you know? So if you're trying to paddle out while you're riding back in, it's very messy, right? So yeah. Write and then rewrite. Okay, so that's one thing. But then how do you know what to leave in and what to leave out? You brought up two great things, you know, War and Peace and a haiku. Now, it would have been a tragedy if, who is it, Tolstoy, right? Mm-hmm. Tried to make a haiku out of War and Peace, right? We would have missed that brilliant novel, okay? So I'm so glad that War and Peace is not a haiku. And a lot of great haikus, if they had been stretched out, they wouldn't be much good, right? Okay, so each piece has its own form. The question again, what do we leave in? What do we leave out? It's an energetic thing. You can feel when you feel, if you've written your piece, like you've gotten it all out, or you think you've gotten it all out, right? And I usually read it aloud. And if I feel a drag, like not in drag, not a drag, but something like, it's like leaning back. When it starts to do that, it's like, oh, maybe I don't need that. You see what I mean? When it's doing this, great, right? It's in the pocket. When it starts to, maybe I don't need that part, or maybe I need to reconfigure that part to bring it in line with the main flow, right? Mm-hmm. And so it's a feel thing. It's a feel thing. It's a rhythm thing. I like to read my work aloud because that way it can bounce off the walls. It can literally be amplified, and I can, you know, hear it before I give it to actors or if it's a novel or whatever. It doesn't matter. I read it aloud. And when it starts to kind of get out of focus, or then either take out the scissors or circle it and do something to bring it into line. Does that help at all?
Yeah, it helps a lot. And I actually just got like 1,000 note cards for the first time ever after what you were talking about the other day. So I'm ready to like tape it all to the wall and go to town.
There you go. Because note cards are good when you're starting out. Note cards are good when you've been going for a while, like Mary with her note cards. Note cards are good after you've done a draft or even two drafts, and you want to get clear and concise, and you start writing things out on note cards. Also time. So you think you were doing this like tofu, right?
Right.
So you want to bring it in. Note cards are great. They're gonna help you bring it in. Also time. You can work for a certain amount of time every day. 30 minutes. I'm just going to focus on this for 30 minutes and I'm going to relax. I'm going to do something else. I'm going to come back and focus for 30 minutes and then I'm going to relax. That kind of thing helps you focus.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's all great. I'm going to show you this guy too before we go. That's it.
Oh, he's very handsome.
Yeah, he was a really good dude.
He's very
awesome dude. Thank you so much. This really helps. Yeah. I can't thank you enough.
Thank
it's
you.
All love. You're changing my life one day at a time. Thank you.
Thanks, Lou.
Thank you.
All right. We actually have a question from Instagram, I believe, from the Public Leaders Instagram that I'm going to read out loud. It is, can we talk a bit about our writing and art as a space for self-care and mental health? Do you have any idea about keeping your practice safe and healthy? Writing through my depression can be either cathartic or dwells in a toxic place. In the latter circumstance, it's very hard to show up to the page.
I'm a musician. My husband's a musician, you know, and so, which means he plays really, really well. And he tells me, he says, you know, when I'm like in there, like noodling and, you know, playing, he's like, remember, music, what does it say? Pythagoras. That's right. It was Pythagoras. Pythagoras said, and I'm like, really? Pythagoras? Pythagoras said that the first and foremost reason why one would play music is to align oneself with one's own spirit. Right? So I said, well, that's exciting. So now when I play music, I think of it differently. It's not like, I gotta get good at these scales, you know, or like that, you know? It's, I'm better aligning myself with my own spirit. So I would say the same thing as of writing, same thing. It's the same thing, because music and the muse and all that, and Pythagoras and the Pythagorean theorem, extra points if anybody can put what that is in the chat, because I forgot. It's something like the right angle of a hypotenuse or some shit. But I would say that that's what writing ultimately is for. That's what our work is for, whatever your work is. James Baldwin said, the day came, I'm paraphrasing, the day came when I decided to be a writer because I thought it best that I heal my people that way, or that I save my people that way, but because I thought it best that I try to save my people that way. So his writing, he said, was an act that he did to save his people, all of us, also to save himself, right? So writing is definitely an act of healing. If you can, person from Twitter, thanks for tweeting in, or Insta, wherever you were from. If you can make a promise to yourself to just keep showing up to the page. Sometimes it's a mountain that you think, I cannot climb this mountain. I didn't say you have to write. I just said, show up to the page and just sit there in front of your notebook. Just keep showing up. That will go be a great, you will be really giving yourself a great gift. And again, not to stop the other things that you're doing to help, you know, with depression, like if you go to therapy or if you are, it's been suggested that you take medication or anything like that. We're not saying stop that. But in addition to all those other things and talking with friends, of course, just keep showing up for yourself. It's really important. So that's what I do.
Thanks, SLP.
You're welcome. It's long answers to short questions.
That's a great answer. And we actually don't have a question at the moment.
Good. We can practice our It's Barbara.
Barbara.
Barbara, everybody. Barbara is an amazing yoga teacher. Barbara is my yoga teacher. When we used to meet in person, it was at the Shala in New York City, which is a brilliant yoga place. And Barbara is an Ashtanga yoga teacher, which means like it's the hardcore shit, but it's the best thing. I think she also teaches online. I'm plugging you, sister. I don't know if that's kosher, but she's really, 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 really good. Okay. Hi, sister. How you doing?
Hi, I'm good. I miss you. I miss you. I love you. I'm totally inspired by you and everyone's questions and your answers. I wanted to ask about the outline that you mentioned earlier. I forget who was speaking, not Lou, but another woman.
Mary, maybe?
Yes.
Mary. Mm-hmm.
And so when that comes in, so, and it also relates to something you were saying, like just write and then rewrite, right? Okay. Like they're separate things. So I'm imagining that outline is maybe another thing.
Mm-hmm.
And when does that come in? Because I find that I write a lot, and it's just like messy to the point where I don't even want to go back to it.
Okay.
And so I think I need some outline.
Okay. Are you enjoying when you write and write and write and write and write? Is it enjoyable? Are you having fun?
Sometimes, yes.
Okay. So I would say that is in the right direction. Okay, so that's good. So you get, when you get to the point where you go, okay, I kind of want to give this a little shape, right? Then that's the moment when you start outlining. It's an organic moment for you, right? Different people start outlining in different places, okay? A lot of people might, instead of doing a lot of writing on the page or on the screen, a lot of people might just noodle it around in their heads for a month or a year or something. You know what I mean? I've just been thinking about this idea for a lot. And then they, okay, which is similar to what you're saying. So you're writing, you got a lot of writing. Now you want to shape. And you say, sometimes you don't even want to go back and look at what you've written. Did you say that? Okay. And you know what? That's okay. For those who do want to go back and see what they've written and pull the outline from that, that's cool. But if you don't want to go back and see what you've written, just see if you can tell yourself the story without looking at your pages. Okay? Just tell yourself the story. Well, you know, I really want to write about this. And the first thing that happens is write it out on an index card. I love index cards because they're small, you know? You can carry them around with you when you go to the park for your socially distanced walk, you know? But you know what I mean? So so it's time to outline. Don't look at the pages because it doesn't feel right. You know, it might put you off. Sit down, pick some time, right? 20 minutes. See if you can tell yourself the story card by card, almost like Polaroid photographs, photograph by photograph. What are you seeing? What's the story? You know what I mean? And that could be a way to introduce outline in an organic way. Also with the writing and rewriting, you want to talk about that. It's like, you know, fabulous yoga teacher sister, inhaling and exhaling. You know, writing, rewriting. You know what I'm saying? So the writing is a long, really long inhale, and then you're rewriting, you know? Like that, okay? So they for me, it's helpful that they're two distinct processes. Like the paddling out to sea, the riding the wave back in. They're distinct processes, and they, I can be more effective if I keep them separate. Other writers write differently. So, and I owe you a call.
Thank you.
Love you. Thanks. Good to see you.
Thanks, Barbara. All right, we've got about 5 minutes left. And we don't have a question at the moment, but let me check one thing. Larry. Go for it, Larry.
I'm going to jump in if no one's going. I would be curious to know to what extent you consider actors and directors while you're writing. And like, how are you, anticipating the way actors and directors will read your work? You talk about, you know, I love the comment you made early about like surrendering the control you don't really have. And how much does the fact that you're writing essentially an unfinished work that is going to get finished by others, just how does that play into your process? Do you do anything about it? Do you release it to the universe? How zen are you about the fact that your work gets interpreted?
Mm-hmm. It's a really good question. For plays and most movies and teleplays I write, I do not write with a performer or a director in mind. Right now I'm working on the genius Aretha, and I'm very much writing for performers in mind because we already cast them and we're about to go back and shoot episode 7. So I'm thinking very much about the actors, but ordinarily I don't think about them at all. I think about actors and I think about a director, but I do not think about anybody specifically.
That is kind of what I mean. I wasn't really thinking about specific people, but like,
sure.
Like, do you try to sort of director proof, actor proof your writing?
I've heard though, there's those phrases used by a writer that I really, really love. I do not. I really work on writing. See, Larry, this is the thing. I mean, don't get the wrong idea. It's not like I don't like control. I just like to exercise the control I have, right? So I let go of the control that I don't have so I can maximize the control that I do have. Don't get me wrong. Yeah, you know, I'm basically, you know, like we all are, if we write plays or TV shows or movies, we're putting words into people's mouths. Hooray! And they love us for it. Oh my gosh, we so love those words that you put into our mouths. Yes, thank you very much. You know, right? But I can't control like every aspect of an actor's performance, right? I have to let that go. I have faith in my community, which most of the time has turned out well. And I write the best, as best I can. And, you know, I take input from my collaborators once we're in the rehearsal room or whatever, and rewrite as much as it takes to get it to where I feel good about it and they feel, you know, we're working together. But yeah, then I let it go. I mean, I feel okay about it because, you know, Shakespeare did it. I mean, right. And August Wilson did it. And Intozake Shange, she did it all right. You know what I'm saying? And there's a long line of people who have practiced this kind of artistic bravery. You know what I'm saying? Right? And so we're like one of them. You have to be very brave. And it's okay. I mean, when I did 365 days, 365 plays, I would go hop around the world and visit theaters that were performing them. I had, the only input I had was giving them pages. And it
into
was
so mine.
There's some freaky shit out there, man. There's some freaky people. Like, whoa, shit, you know? And it's all very beautiful. It was all very beautiful. And not what I expected.
Appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you. Great question, man. Great question. It's 6 o'clock.
It's 6 o'clock on a Wednesday.
On a Wednesday.
Here we are. Well, thanks everybody. It's great as always. We, as a reminder, please sign up by 3 p.m. Eastern, Monday through Thursday. You can sign up on the Public Theaters website or HowlRound, and I will send you a link between 3 and 4:30 p.m. Eastern. That's all.
Someone, good luck finding your phone.
Oh, God. If I call you, you know I found it.
Okay. Bye. Love you guys. Bye.
Love you. Thank you, SLP.